Welcome to the Dork Forest. Jackie and her pals will never bore us. Shameless confessions
about our obsessions
will make us laugh and smile. So let's explore the Dork Forest and dork out for a while.
Hello and welcome to March, Rangers of the Dork Forest. My name is Jackie Cation and you're listening to the Dork Forest. JackieCation.com, DorkForest.com, TheDorkForest.com. These are the websites. We don't have a sponsor yet this month, but you could always donate. Don't forget that you could give me $100 a year for listening to this content for free on the iTunes. And you could review if you don't have $100 a year. You could just and you could buy merch at JackieCation.com. Here's the good news. There is a new comedy special, my new hour-long comedy special, stand-up comedy special video on allthingscomedy.com/records. $5 download out March 4th. There's a limited edition t-shirt available, a Horcrux Tour t-shirt, available till March 14th. And I need a pre-order of 100 to print them. Because they are eight-color fancy pants, and they're going to be on union-made American black t-shirts, much like the Ranger t-shirts, the same style, Bayside. But they're expensive to make, and I'm only going to do 100 of them or 200 of them, however many. I'm not going to do more than 200 of them because I'm tired. But they're a great t-shirt of Jenny Fine's design of the cover of the CD and the DVD. And order them. Order them at JackieCation.com/Horcrux and get the special at allthingscomedy.com/records. Right now, let's get into the show, because it's March. Hey, it's Jackie Cation. I am here with John Roy in my living room here in Van Nuys.
What's up?
And let's just do this, at John Roy Comic on Twitter.
Right? Yes,
that's what
it.
We know now, because
that's
we just talked for 4 minutes about many different things, and I had not recorded.
Yeah, mildly amusing at best, but if you want to know the basic beats, we made fun of the fact that my website was Flash, and directed you instead to Twitter,
it
which
is with
at...
music?
Yeah, it does. So it's I made that website in like Dane Cook height of everything, like 2006. So like the idea was I'm going to make it like Dane's or like, you know, whatever these big flashy websites were. So yeah, it starts with a loop that plays snippets of Take Five and Beastie Boys.
Right when you hit in John Roy,
it's even worse than that.
.com.
And stand up starts. Like it's just a full assault of insanity.
Wow, you have to turn that crap off.
I know, but it's expensive. I gotta go get it.
Oh, you have to do someone to do it.
Yeah, like, oh, I mean, you can pause it. There's little buttons on the screen that lets you get rid of all that shit.
Right.
But
it's in the code where it says start when it loads. And so, like, I did mine for years, and I did my own one. And then Vilmos, who does my website now, he was like, please, please, for the love of God, can I fix this? And he did. He's done a great job with JackieCation.com. But the thing is I was like, so... do you think I should play the video right when they get there? And he said, no one wants that, Jack. No one wants that.
We all thought they did, though. Like, we were all like, what's that episode of Simpsons where Bart gets a camcorder and he puts a star wipe on everything? Like,
right.
Like, let's start it like it's like, we'll start with Nene with stand-up, and then there'll be a 3D light show. And
then a sandwich will
fire out of the fucking hard drive. Why did we think that... The only way these people are going to be cool with your website is if you get them, you grab them, like it's like,
right from the get, right from the get.
I really thought that was what to do.
Like, right, right. Well, we didn't know. We were just like, well, when we get on stage, there's not a lot of silence.
Right. You get you know? That big. Although you know what I do now, like when the guy brings me up, goes like, "Are you ready for your headliner?" And then they clap, and then he goes, "That wasn't good enough. Are you ready for your headliner?" Like, I go up now and I go, that was mean. That was dicky. Why'd he do that to you guys?
Right,
like,
right.
I tell them. I'm like, that you right. making you clap again? Like,
right, it's all so crazy. It's. Do you ever tell the MC just not...
No, I make fun of him until he gets it.
Oh, right. Yeah. Welcome to some background of how stand-up comedy works.
Yeah.
Here's the other ball-busting. I had somebody... a perfectly nice young man who...
They're all nice.
It's
nice. They
can't
believe they're working with a headliner or having a great time.
Whatever. They can't believe that they're doing stand-up.
Yeah.
And well, none of us can, right?
No, I was nice.
So the face... Oh my God. This is how we all learned. We all learned that you don't come into town into Los Angeles. I was doing a real nice club, Flappers, right?
Sure.
So I get a Facebook message from a comic that I worked with 2 years ago from wherever. And he goes, hey, I'm in town this weekend. Do you have an opener for your Flappers gig? Because I'd be willing to open for you. And I ignored it. I was like, Dude, it's a club. They booked the opener. Yeah, you didn't. And day of, you might want to give me some notice. I might have been able to get you a guest set, but give me at least a month or so. And so I just ignored it, gave him the benefit of the doubt. I was like, okay, fine, whatever. And then he tweets at me. He's like, hey, did you get my message about opening for you?
Tweets at you.
At Flappers.
Not direct message.
No, because like, I'm not following him.
Right.
And I said, did you think that I booked the club? Because I don't book the. And I just started busting on his balls.
You
and he was
it's
like,
not called Cations.
The club is not Cations Comedy Club. Ooh, with all K's. KKK.
There's a certain person, and I'm not going to say any names, but there's a person that lives here in Los Angeles that we'll have some beers. But the third beer is where the can I middle for you request is floating.
Oh, Christ.
Like if you, the first two is all pleasant conversation.
Yes.
The third beer has the take me on the road.
Take me on the road.
So
like,
if you get to
I don't have that
three,
kind of
get
power.
Ready for it. Like,
yeah. I mean,
oh, so if you want to come to Ohio for $450, is that what you want? Because that's
right.
all I got.
Right. Because I can't bump
you.
Your money.
Yeah.
And like, I'm not allowed to bring, I'm not at that level. And quite honestly, I'm very sorry. Everybody's very nice. But right. if I could pick someone to go with, I would pick like a friend of mine
yeah.
who I want to spend 5 days with.
I know all most of my stuff's in the Midwest. I know a lot of great comedians in Chicago that I would
that are already there.
That I've seen and went, you're great. I want to bring you. Like it goes the other what people don't understand is it goes
and they
the
can't
other
understand.
Way. It's
yeah.
not just a you like I don't know. Do you think like bands go walk into the satellite and then, oh, look, hey, it's Prince is on stage. Hey, Prince, you got what, the LA Forum? Like, did you watch our set? Like
right.
who the fuck? You can't
well,
do that.
And they can't, and people, nobody knows until, because the thing is, I've tried to tell comics nicely. I've tried to bust their balls. The ball busting seems to leave a lasting impression. The mocking.
Yeah.
The out and out mocking is the only way to go. Guess what? I can't get you free tickets to Maria's show because by definition, it's Maria's show.
Yeah.
And I don't even know you. So I think Maria's sister, I think can ask for free tickets. And then Maria says, aren't you a doctor? Why don't you buy tickets?
Why is free so important to you?
Right. Why? Yeah. yeah. What is, I mean, you can come backstage. I love you. We'll have dinner.
I'm in that program where poor kids who have nothing are turned into stand-ups and we need to have any
right.
free things we can. To-
sure. Oh, I'm not paying for stand-up, but that's because I'm a stand-up.
Yeah.
I saw Chappelle yesterday.
Yeah.
I was at the coffee shop over by the Improv and Fred Siegel
okay.
having lunch. And all of a sudden he came in and I don't know him. I've
sure.
never met him.
I met him once, but it's not much of a meeting. Hello.
Hello. Nice Chappelle. To meet you.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
And so I just stared at him for a second. And I was like, get it together. Because he's such a great stand-up comic, right?
Oh, I mean, this sounds even silly to even have to mention this, but people like Matt Bronger has said that he just worked with him. Said it was the funniest shit he's ever seen, ever.
Ever.
I know somebody in Denver. He did the Comedy Works. They saw all 5 shows.
Right.
They said that he did each joke differently every time with
right.
different lines.
Right.
Like, what?
Every single time funny.
Why?
Every time. Right. Yeah. So, I mean, so it is, it's in, when you see somebody who's that good that you know, you're like, oh, and he doesn't, I mean, what am I going to do? Go up to him and say, hey, I do stand-up.
Yeah, hey, maybe you saw me on Conan.
Would you want me to open for you? No. No, Jackie, no. Keep it together. It's like when yeah. I ended up saying the gooniest thing ever because he came and sat next to me waiting for his to-go order.
Oh, really?
And I was
so
done.
You, okay.
And I was wrapping it up and I just, all I did was I got up, I got my items, I paid my bill. I stood up and I just looked at him and I said, you're a really great stand-up comic in that tone of dorky, dorky tone. And he went, thank you. Thank you very much. And I said, have a good day. And then I just kept walking. And he was
that,
like,
you know what, though? You got out easy. That's good.
That's
I mean,
fine.
There are to much worse I met a cool guy
right.
moments.
Right. Oh, my God. I could have lost my mind. And luckily, right. I did not. I kept it together.
I like when you're telling jokes. I got to go.
Oh, look. A verb. Good for you, Jackie. Okay. So we're
yes.
here to talk about a lot of different things.
Yes.
But let's get to painting Warhammer
40K
miniatures.
Painting Warhammer 40K miniatures. All right, okay, when you do that, you have to feel when you're painting these things, there is a knowledge in that hobby maybe more than any of how much one company has manipulated you. Like, because there's only one company that runs Warhammer, and it's called Games Workshop.
They make
all the miniatures, they make all the rules, and really the rules of the games are just there to sell more miniatures. They sell very fine-crafted lead. Well, I don't know. They're not lead anymore.
They can't be lead.
No, like, they're it's not like, making all of America stupid. Like, there is – it's whatever the hell they're made out of. Right. I don't know. But and they have plastic ones, too.
But they're heavy.
They're heavy, but then they also have little plastic ones for the bulk of your army. Because you're supposed to make like an army of like 150 of these things.
Oh, my gosh.
Like, and you play each other in these massive tabletop board games.
Right.
Here is the problem with me. I never was very good at the game.
Okay.
So when I finally assembled my army and I painted them all – little backstory. When I was 14, I wanted to be a visual artist. And
okay.
I took art lessons and I went all the way until I hit a wall of my talent level, which was three-point perspective. I could not – fucking do it.
Oh, you can't see it for some reason.
I just can't paint it right. Like,
okay.
I got to the point, I painted my still life, I painted my figure drawings,
yeah.
I did all, and in my head, I'm going to be the next fucking Jim Lee. I'm going to be, you know, John Byrne. I'm going to be the best comic book artist. I get to three-point perspective, and I just can't do it at all. Like,
Do you have depth perception,
no,
or are you just not really
just
good at it?
Not really good at it.
Okay, so it's okay, but it's not great.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
I could draw. I was that kid in grade school that like, well, your Batman looks like a Batman picture.
Yeah,
maybe you should move to the next level. You know.
Yeah.
And so I did, and then I got to the level where I'm taking private art lessons, and you know, not super expensive. But I found a local artist,
right, right.
I paid him some money, and so I'm sitting there, and I just can't get it.
Okay.
So. Visual art gets put on the back burner. I try playing guitar for many years. That doesn't work. I find improv. I end up having to pay
comedy.
Them more than I have to do improv. And then at that
right.
moment, I find... So I get stand-up. I get a career, blah, blah, blah. But in the back of my head, it's always this visual art thing.
Right.
So I get these miniatures. And when I'm playing D&D, I buy these Games Workshop miniatures. And I start painting them. And I'm horrible at it. And my mom goes, are you priming them? And I'm like, oh, fuck, I'm not priming the miniatures.
Oh.
So that's why the paint isn't adhering
oh.
to the thing. So once I figure out around 15 how to prime them, I start getting pretty good at it. So I'm not good at painting.
Is your mom a painter?
No, but she was just walked downstairs and goes, well, you're not going to get.
It's not going to stay.
Yeah, so then like.
So she has some information
yeah,
in her
yeah,
mind.
Yeah, she has some brain. She has a working mind. She's not a moron like right. I was.
She has some information.
Yeah,
she's an adult. You are a child. I get it.
A child who thought Iron Maiden was a good band. Like, you know, they're, like there's some things.
No,
you know,
no, yeah,
I'm,
yeah.
I'm 15.
Right,
know,
right. There's
like,
no way. You don't think of everything.
I'm a
yeah.
dummy. Sometimes I leave the no. soup on until it's solidified. Because, you know,
right,
like, I mean, like,
right.
That's something I do sometimes.
Right, that'll happen.
So, start painting the miniatures. Get pretty good at it. Don't really think about it till I get a bunch of money. I win Star Search on CBS
That's
with Arsenio.
Right.
I moved
That's
to
right.
Los Angeles. I am not a very good stand-up comedian because I've just been a middle. Like
right.
I win Star Search at 30 minutes.
Okay.
And so I go out on the road. I get every national improv kick me in the dick and don't rebook me. I come back to L.A. Mm-hmm. I have no real career to speak of. So I got a lot of time on my hands, but I got a lot of money.
When
so
is this?
I'm like... It's about 2005, 2004
okay.
when I moved here.
Right.
So I'm not getting a lot of spots, and I'm not particularly good at stand-up. And
okay.
I've moved to L.A. in what is perhaps a rash decision.
Okay.
And so I've got a lot of money and not a lot to do.
Right. And
so
this is 10 years ago. You're like, let's have a hobby.
That in Westminster, there is one of these mega centers of that the Games Workshop company has built. To attract little fat kids like moths to a flame.
Westminster, California?
Westminster, California. If you take the 405 way south.
Okay.
And you start seeing parts of the OC that are not in the brochure.
Okay.
You know, like people think of the OC as this all ritzy, rich. It's
yeah.
just Rick Warren's Saddleback Church and a bunch of housewives. Well, there's other parts of the OC too.
Right, right.
There's a mega factory by Bellflower that's just belching shit into the sky 24/7.
Sure.
And there's a town called Westminster that is mostly 7-Elevens and Del Tacos, but everything's written in old-timey English font for no reason.
Okay.
But they have a battle
a giant
center.
Warhammer battle center.
It's in a strip mall by, I think the anchor is like a Payless. I mean, we're not
right.
talking about,
right.
you know. But there's this mega center down there. And so I went and I bought an entire army of Imperial Guard. I think it
Imperial Guard.
Probably cost me $550, maybe
okay.
more.
And is Imperial... let's back up a little bit. Warhammer is orcs and elves and humans.
In space.
But Warhammer 40K.
Yeah, you're right. Okay, so Warhammer, there's regular Warhammer, which
right.
is... orcs, elves, humans, and also these demon chaos people.
Oh, right, right. And the demon chaos. And everybody has their own army.
Yes.
And it's 150 guys per that you're supposed to really have.
Now, there are some cheesy armies that have like four chaos demons and then six other random, but like you put all your points into four massive
guys. Which is why when you go into one of these game stores, they need a giant platform.
Yeah, there's a special table.
And how many, like, do four people play? Like, how many people
can? I mean, in general, it's just one-on-one.
Okay.
But there are massive, and even if me, if I fought you,
right,
and we used
this
just
card
a
table.
Basic army,
yeah,
you know, 100 point, like, I forget the point totals, but something that you could reasonably expect it to have, like, that a 12-year-old plus his buddy might have made that army together.
Right, right.
That's still a two-hour battle.
Right, right.
You have to measure everything out with a ruler. You have to, you know,
I
move
see it
everyone.
With like, yeah, with
tape, it's all tape measure. The
tape
whole
measure?
Game is tape measure.
Just because of line of sight? Is that
line
what I'm
saying?
Am
sight,
I correct?
And then, yeah, you need line of sight, but then also every weapon has a different distance.
Okay.
That's in inches. So you're.
So do they have like D&D books?
Yeah.
That have all the rules?
Do they have every. Could they sell you it? They've made it.
Right. Okay. Right. So there's charts in the books which tell you the distance of your dude or
your. Games Workshop Company is excellent at making money, Jackie.
Well, their business
model. We've found a way to process pure nerdism into English pound sterling.
Are they British? Is it a British company?
A British company. They're in London and it's all fucking money.
They are dipped, man.
They know how to do it, too.
Well, but here's what I was told about the game part of it is that everybody has the reason.
Were
it
you
can
told
take,
that I'm horrible at it because you should have been. That should have been it.
Well, you know, because Andy said that he used to play it and he just all I when I told him that you were into Warhammer 40K, he was like, "No, the worlds are amazing. What they did is they created this orc.
Oh yeah, the
world's
demon
world.
Yeah,
and then." And then what they did, the next version was 40,000 years in the future.
And
so
it's
they
all
could put
crazy,
it in
dark
space.
It's based on the space setting is based on the idea is like it's they kept the medieval mindset.
Okay.
So the human empire is a horrible place with an emperor and it's like really
Wait,
religious.
Isn't the emperor and, a vampire?
Yeah, he's a vampire.
And
they're
he's
not
been,
good people.
Even the
good guys are bad.
So everybody's
like,
just
mine
a mess.
Was the Imperial Guard was my army. They're
and
like
was,
the
and are they
troops.
Human?
Yeah, they're humans.
Okay.
They have some mutants and shit in there and some experiments, but they're basically human. There's two armies that the human empire have. They have the Space Marines, which are basically a Captain America in an Iron Man suit.
Okay.
He's genetically engineered, and then he also has power armor on.
Okay.
And those guys are like the main, those are what Warhammer would like you to buy. They're kind of the Spider-Man of their universe.
Oh, okay.
They want you to buy, and they're the people that every young kid goes, Space Marines! Like, they're the one. But.
Yeah, the word Space Marines makes me want to just go fight something.
Yeah, so
it's awesome.
As all nerdery goes,
yep.
If there's the obvious John Cena nerd thing that you're all supposed to buy.
What's John Cena?
Well, he's like the big WWE wrestler that all the kids are supposed to root for. Hulk Hogan from our era.
Okay, there we go.
But if you're going to be, but then there's also that nerd personality that goes, ooh, Hulk Hogan, that's who the WWF is pushing on me. I'm going to be a fan of Macho Man. You know what I mean? Like there's that nerd Pepsi drinking, Burger King eating number two, what else is out there.
Right.
I'm not going to like Batman. I'm going to like Nightwing mentality.
Right, right.
So that was me.
You can get super specific as to what your nerd dorkdom is. Yeah.
So I was like, I don't want this Space Marine thing. Ooh, look, what's that army? So there's a second army called the Imperial Guard. They are the humans. They don't have space armor. They're just dudes with guns trying to fight these aliens.
Oh, okay.
So they're just an army. They're all conscripted from horrible worlds that, like, if they find, like, one, there's a chaos force that mutates everyone. And if the Inquisition of the Empire finds one shred of chaotic, like one mutant
gene
on the planet, they will orbit strike the entire world and destroy it.
Okay.
Because they have to keep mutations out of their empire. Because those mutants aren't just X-Men mutants. Those mutants have been, they got mutated by worshiping some kind of Cthulhu kind of god.
Oh, okay.
And if we don't destroy the whole planet, then that's another chaos.
Welcome
world,
to the Dork right? Forest, where you have referenced like nine different worlds from WWE to Cthulhu to X-Men to Batman.
Well, what I'm saying, these
awesome.
Games Workshop people, they have made this.
I'm just saying, why weren't you on the show 8 years ago?
We tried.
We have been trying for at least 2 years.
The very first Bridgetown, we were talking about doing this.
Totally.
I think I was too hungover in the hotel, so I didn't get to do it.
Right. All good.
So, anyways, the Imperial Guard is. Basically, they're based on the Russians at Stalingrad. Like, there's a guy called the Commissar that just can shoot a guy in the head to improve morale.
Oh,
like,
okay.
If somebody's going to desert, you just shoot him. And the look of the soldiers is based on World War II. So,
okay.
Like, they're sci-fi World War II.
Oh, cool.
So they have tanks that look like a World War I, World War II tank, but then it has plasma guns and fucking rail guns and shit.
Right.
And then they have, like, your regular grunt who looks like an English Tommy from 1945.
Okay.
But he's got an awesome laser gun and, like,
sure.
So they're basically their space World War II.
That's awesome. What's their color scheme?
Well, there's many different regiments of the Imperial Guard.
Okay.
So the ones I chose to paint are kind of the basic Imperial Guard called the Cadians, which are sort of like, they look like the British Army.
Okay.
There's also the Catachan Jungle Fighters, which are based on the 80s action movie version of Vietnam. Like, pretty much, like, they all look like the guys in Predator. Like, they're all muscle. They all have fucking headbands and shit. They look like halfway between the Predator Strike Force and Apocalypse. Like, so those are the Catachan Jungle Fighters.
Right.
I don't play them. I play the Cadians. I did some modifications. I used Space Marine Scouts as my sergeants. Like, I've done a lot of things. And I painted a damn good army. Like,
yeah.
I painted like a Union Jack color scheme on all their flags.
Okay.
I've got a group of Grey Knights, which are like Space Marine types that can fight with the Guard. And I painted them like medieval knights.
Can you send me a picture of one of the good-looking
dude? I'll send you a picture of the whole thing.
Yeah.
But, unfortunately, I found that I'm not good at the game.
The actual game itself.
So when I finally assembled this well-painted army that I, to this day, can stare at and feel satisfaction from having painted beautiful miniatures. Although I must say, I must take a tiny side thing. One of the things that Games Workshop publishes is a magazine called White Dwarf.
Okay.
And that is the magazine for the hobbyist of Warhammer.
Okay.
But what it really is they're professional painters showing off and making you cry. So you buy the new White Dwarf as this sort of like Warhammer porn.
Yeah.
But then you look at – their painters are incredible, Jackie. Like,
right.
They're like – if Michelangelo got paid by some British toy company to paint fucking Space Marines and Chaos Lords.
Because I was looking at some of the images of these things.
It's beautiful.
They're gorgeous. And the detail – because these guys are only like an inch tall, some of them, right?
Yeah, you gotta paint with a magnifying glass if you get the facial features right. It's insanity.
And I'm pretty good. Right, and you
were pretty
good.
When I look at what they do,
there's like one hair on a brush or something?
Yeah.
And you're like, okay, well, I have to get this insignia
you
right.
You sit there all day just with your hands like carpal tunnel factory.
Right,
you
know, just hunched over a microscope.
Yeah, with like
microscope.
Some 14-year-old kid next to you going, were you on Ferguson?
You're like, get off me.
That 14-year-old kid who will go on to destroy your army.
Right.
With a horribly painted mishmash force that he cobbled together in study hall.
Now, why is that?
Because he knows all the rules.
Okay.
There is a mindset. I'm a right brain guy. I don't have a lot of math skills. I can't play chess.
Right.
I can paint. I can make music.
Right.
So the painting side, I got pretty good at. Now, not as good as these guys in the magazine who are just like, oh my God, it's like you just figured out fucking your first Nirvana song. And
then
the guy in the magazine's like, watch me play Van Halen.
You know, right.
Like, that's what it feels like to be painting.
Yeah.
So anyway, I play these kids. And here's the mixture of the people that play the game, though. That's a left brain mentality.
Okay.
So it's like ex-military guys who fucking learn the von Clausewitz and shit.
Oh, right.
Then like 14-year-old math
nerds. Like Axis and Allies.
Yeah, who have min-maxed their army because they just poured over the book in bed every night while they're not getting laid.
They sit around and they go,
hmm.
And so they're buying new characters because every year Warhammer creates new
and they retcon and reboot everything, so your codex is no good. There's these codexes that have all the rules for your army.
Yeah.
And in order to keep, because say you're me and you've painted your Imperial Guard, you bought five tanks, you bought everything that's reasonable to buy.
Yeah.
You have all of the miniatures painted. So how are they going to get any more money out of me?
Well,
4 years down the road, we'll re-release all new miniatures, and then we'll change the rules. So your old rule book is obsolete now.
And
we're in fifth
edition.
You can't
be in any sort of tournament either, right? Because
no, you can't. It is an insidious, it is next to improv lessons for total Scientology ripoff.
Because the next generation of every little dude is slightly more powerful. So if you play that old army, you're going to get wiped off the planet,
just change all the rules on you. Like, Blood Angels can no longer infiltrate. You know, they'll have just some fun. And so your whole strategy, too, these little kids that beat the shit out of me every week, they all have these cheesy strategies that they've developed from looking in the book and going, seems here if I put all my points towards infiltration and forecode the grenades that the unit is issued with and then made them around a tech priest, we can then give that bonus to all of them and then I'll field six of these units and no las cannons and I'll destroy them. And that kid spent five Lunchable packs worth of eating time to come up with this thing.
Yeah.
And then he basically just does the Warhammer equivalent of fools mating you. So you have a 12-year-old kid who's like the Kasparov of the Blood Angels.
Right.
And he's fucking just making mincemeat out of your beautifully painted British tribute army.
Right. So, right. So what you have is a beautifully painted tribute army and they are just swallowing
And
the
I'm
books.
Just going, so I'll just buy guns for all of them? Like, I have no idea. My mind just doesn't, even when I played D&D, my fighter was just a fun guy to play and play the game. He wasn't min-maxed. I didn't know whether I had the right dual-wielding bonus. I just wanted to fight with two swords.
Right.
You know, like, then you play with a guy like Brian Ballinger, who's another role-playing guy who's also in comedy world.
Is he a min-max guy?
Oh, yeah. Jared Logan and I played with him, and he is a min-max machine.
Jared Logan's doing the next show.
Oh, Logan. Oh, dude. He got all the good dorks.
Yeah.
Like, Logan and I, we may play some role-playing this summer.
I play 3.5 Eberron once a month, and then I play Pathfinder every couple
Pathfinder
of months.
Okay, Pathfinder Logan plays. I haven't played RPG role-playing.
I used to play Champions, and I was in a...
That's like min-max city Champions, right? I mean, that's almost like you need a math degree.
No. Yeah, totally. I was like, just tell me how many dice to roll. Just tell me how many. Just give me the graph and tell me how to do it. But a lot of Andy's friends are, you know, he said that we've mostly weeded out the min-max guys because I don't want to play with those guys because they're gaming the system and I just want to play.
Yeah, it's supposed to be fun.
Right. And, you know? And he just wants to have fun. And you're like, if you're going to get mad if you lose, just don't play. Go find someone else that you can. I mean, and then you're gonna gloat. And I was like, you can gloat, but
like, there's a lot of things in a game, and some people's personalities aren't the let's get involved in a cool story and try to use our brains to solve this problem. There is the.
I'm a total munchkin. I just want to kick open a door, kill somebody, and then roll the body.
I want to do the silly voice I made up.
You want to do the character?
Yeah, I want to do some. I want to go into town and try to find the bad guy, and you know, I want to do some Sherlock Holmes in. You know what I mean? Like I kind of like that aspect of the game. And, you know, when I was a dungeon master when I was in junior high and high school,
what were you playing? Three
basic.
Oh,
I played Mystara.
Okay.
Because I played the rule cyclopedia, just the basic fighters are fighters, no lawful is lawful.
What version was it? Not advanced.
Rule cyclopedia, basic D&D.
Okay, yeah.
With the red book, then the blue book, and then you all the companion set.
Yeah, yeah.
They were like late 80s. They were basically the original Gygax rules carried away through level 36. And they had a really good, they had probably the best source books that D&D ever made. It was called the Mystara series. They were the Gazetteers. And you can get them on for free in a torrent now. I mean, TSR doesn't exist anymore, so you're not really stealing from anybody. But they're the best.
Aren't they owned by Wizard of the Coast?
Yeah, but they don't. All that stuff's out of print.
Oh, like, they haven't re-released
these are from 1985.
Okay.
Like,
so
you know,
Mystara series.
Mystara. It's really great. It's the best. It's the best art direction. The best source books they ever did. And the rules were the simplest ever to run. They were this basic rule cyclopedia that was the easiest. So that's what I ran because I didn't want to get bogged down in whether your monk slash assassin, multi-class, dual-wielding half-elf with his racial bonus. I don't give a fuck. I don't want to do that.
Right.
You're a fighter. You're a sword. Well, let's get this mission going. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah, there's so many different ways. Like, I don't read any of them. I don't read any of the books. And I play with these guys who, it's sitting next to their bed. You know, they're 45-year-old men who are like, well, I'm going to read that chapter about cleric spells. And
I couldn't even do that when I was the age where that was appropriate. Even at 13, I couldn't do that.
I don't think that there's the thing is, they're into the storyline, the background, and what it all, and how it was all created. So
read a novel. That's what I have to say.
No, no.
You know what I mean? Like, they get to do.
Safe space, brother. Safe space. They get to do whatever they want.
Yeah.
But if you don't want them to, that's fine. But it's like...
No, I'm just saying that if I'm going to... I like that sort of thing, too.
But
I would rather some amazing author wrote a cool story than just read back
which is what
dry
they think.
Source books.
That's
stuff.
What they think it is. They think it's a cool author who's written a thing. I don't want to read it either.
Yeah.
But the thing is if you, if, and I'm psyched they've read it because I'm sitting around and I'm like, well, what can this guy do? And I get two different perspectives from the five people I'm playing with because they've swallowed the damn books. Because they, right. they read it.
It's written in, under yeah. their eyelids.
Right, like, right. Because they read those books like I read fiction and reread the fiction. Like the great fiction that I've always loved. I reread
I
those
never
books.
Found, I mean, because a source book doesn't have a story. I mean, maybe it
I
has
think it
like.
It does. I think, I like.
I've read a ton of them. Like, right. When I was, but like, I just.
But the Eberron world, like, they're constantly telling me about the gods and the, and the, and the, and the, and part of it, maybe part of it, they're making up a story.
No, I just mean in the source book itself, right, the right. way it's written is like. This is the city. This, these are the gods. The priesthood has three sects. There is the High Templar.
Right.
But there maybe. Isn't. Mike goes into the High Templar and he right. kills the dude. Now he's wanted for murder. Like, right. that's what isn't there.
Right. So maybe they're writing that story as they read those things.
Well, we're the story. I mean, the right, RPG but, is supposed to be the story.
Right. But they play the game. So maybe right. they're the story in yeah, that exactly. book when they're
okay,
doing it.
So maybe that's, just absorbing background material.
Right. Because I don't know what they get out of it.
Makes their experience more rich.
Right.
Okay.
For them, and that's fine.
Right.
What I find more rich is that they've read the damn books, and I don't.
And you
have
don't
to.
Have to.
Right, and yeah. it's so great because then the game can be, the game can be that it can be that great because it, everyone
right.
brings, especially like in D, like I like D&D the best, and I, this one D&D game we've been playing it for 10 years.
How what level is your person, or have you gone?
I am a, I think I'm a 16th level, so I'm like
that's amazing for D&D.
Well, and I mean, the monsters. Are,
I've never met a set more of a, more than a 7th level character.
Well,
I never met anyone who
Andy's
got that far.
The, Andy's the game master, and he said it's impossible. You guys are gods. You're superheroes, and I have to find enemies for you.
Yeah, 16th level fighter is just like
I'm,
you know.
I'm a shadow dancer and a rogue, and so an archer, and so
all sniper
and a great tumbling, and I have four arms and I can jump
I
over
go
people.
Bashy boy. Oh, single wheeled sword guy. I mean, always.
Kevin Flanagan is a Warcraft, War Buttercup. What the fuck? I named him because when I first started playing D&D, I didn't. We found this witch in the middle of the woods, and they said, "Well, you have three questions."
That's
and
where
I,
they live.
And I said, "How tall are you?" And Andy goes, "That's one question."
Yeah.
And I was like, "No, I'm so sorry. I was just riffing." Was like, the other three just looked at me
like, "Not time for funny, Jackie."
Right. The hilarity. Put it on hold, Cation. And so I've learned. And then, like one time, we were in the jungles of this monster country, and we ran into these like slea stack like dudes, and so the slea stack goose had aging arrows, and they aged some of the, and so our cleric had to like reverse that, but I picked up some aging arrows to use on, I was like, well, I'll use it on them, that's what I'll do. And
right.
so the next thing that we run into is a baby dragon, and I was like, should I shoot it with an aging arrow? And three people go, no. And Andy, game master, goes, if you want to. Because how would you know instinctively that dragons become more powerful and smarter the
well,
older they get?
You might just use simple size. That well, tiny dragon,
the tiny
is
dragon
much
versus
easier.
A giant yeah. magical powerful
Godzuki
dragon.
And Godzilla. I mean, I think that would be the image that would guide
right.
me to not shooting the baby
you
dragon
were dipped
with the aging
into
arrow.
I know. Well, I didn't shoot the.
Or if you watch Game of Thrones in reverse, and you can see how the dragon shrink down to a manageable egg.
Oh, interesting. Yeah. Interesting. I don't think I thought of it that way. Yeah. I know. I was like, you know, because my whole thing when I play these games,
did
I'm
you
like
guys
you.
Get team wiped?
We almost died. We've almost died. Like one time, Lee couldn't.
How hardcore is your game master on death? Does he? If you're dead, you're dead, or does he fudge it? Or like
he's pretty forgiving, except for that he. The Pathfinder game that I'm in is with Eric as the game master, and he wants us to die.
He's that guy.
He's
the sadistic boy.
He like, wants, he's like, no, well, you're probably going to die here. And then he's trying. And Andy's
don't you just
thing,
feel like ants with a magnifying glass over you with that sort of dungeon master?
I don't, yeah, I've only played, and then the other one was the Champions game, and that was with, I was Phil and Jim. But it was, and the science on that one was amazing. It was like he had created this science fiction world. So I do think, like, the game master makes the whole experience different. From one
oh, of
person.
Course. No, actually, everything is secondary to who your game master is. Yeah, like nothing else matters. Because you could play, I could play like something that interests me not at all, like Cthulhu,
okay,
with a great dungeon master and have a great time.
The party
and I
of
can
a lifetime.
Play the DC universe with my own classic versions of every character set in a city of my choice with a bozo dungeon master and hate my life.
Right. You know what and I mean? Just go, like, I just wasted you know, 3 hours.
Yeah,
of my life.
Like it's all just the personality.
Yeah. And
because I, so
what's your favorite?
My favorite what?
Game Master kind of.
Game Master,
the way they run it.
I think that my own way of doing it is a little soft, and I need if I ever did it again, I let him live too much. Because I always Game Mastered. I never played.
Okay.
Like, I was always the GM when I, because nobody else would do it.
Oh,
and I had the books, so I was having, I had to be the guy. And I could do voices, and I could do improv and stuff to make it fun.
Right, and so you like the story part of it, too, because you got to write the story.
I think I let him fudge rolls too much. I think I let him live too much. I should have been
a little harder?
Yeah. I don't think I should have been that guy that you had, like, basically, you know, no, will you die? No, how will I kill you? Like, I don't want to be that guy.
Right.
But
and
I felt like I probably... there should have been a little more element of, I think they got a little cocky
because
you know, and I feel like there should have been a couple more brushback pitches. I should have thrown a little more fucking Bob Gibson at him.
Okay.
You know what I mean? Like, I don't think they should have.
I don't
been
know
it.
Who Bob Gibson is.
Bob Gibson
is,
was a 1960s St. Louis Cardinal pitcher who would just throw it right at your head.
Okay.
Because that was cool back then, because it's like, oh, you're getting a little cocky, batter? Yeah, it's coming at your head. Move.
Okay.
So I felt like if no one ever dies.
Right.
Then they never get that. They're like, oh, well, this DM just wants to play, and he's so thankful the players are at his living room eating his chips right now that he's just going to let us fucking, you know, I didn't know that the orc was over there, so I feel like I should probably get like a reroll, you know?
Yeah, that's,
like, you know?
Yeah.
So it wasn't that bad, but I felt like I should have been a little harsher.
Right, right. Well, I think that's it's a learned skill, too.
It's a middle ground.
Right. I mean, and there's ways to learn how to play the damn game. Like, cause I never played board games or anything until I met Andy. I'm the youngest of six. The only board games we played were Nightmare, Sibling Rule, Monopoly.
Awful Monopoly. Everyone cries.
Yeah. All we're trying to do is hurt your feelings.
I love that. Did you see The Kings of Summer?
I didn't.
There's a great scene in that movie. I'm not going to spoil it, but where a Monopoly game is used for. Nick Offerman is in it.
Okay.
Well, some of comedians we know, Hannibal and Kamel, have little cameos. But,
okay.
But it's a really good movie. Jordan Vogt Roberts directed it. But the point is, there's a Monopoly game that is a metaphor for horrible tensions between the characters.
Oh my
and
God.
It gets really ugly. Mm-hmm. And it's a beautiful scene that uses Monopoly to really fuck with people.
Right. So ever since that sounds awesome. But the way that I've learned how to play games. And the way that I've watched different people run games has been its own learning experience.
Well, and that's where Warhammer is different because it isn't a role-playing game. It's a war game.
It's
there is
just
no
a board
GM.
Game.
So the min-maxer wins because...
He's min-maxed.
And it's just me versus you.
Right.
Or me and a friend versus you and a friend.
Right.
It's just a battle.
Right.
And so it isn't... Like, there is a RPG version of Warhammer if you choose to play it.
Right.
But the main game is just me versus you, my army versus your army, and it's almost won at the beginning when you've chosen your force.
Okay.
So deciding what points to spend where is where you win.
Okay.
And when you actually get into... And now, there's a lot of dice rolling just like anything else.
Right.
So you could have some massive tank and some lowly dude rolls a... fucking 20 or whatever you need, and he blows up your tank. And that's possible.
Okay.
It's kind of like Risk in that way where you've had this great... It's not as ridiculous as Risk where there's almost no strategy at all and you could have two slot machines play each other and that would be...
Risk Legacy? Have you played that one?
No.
That's the one where you can only play it 15 times because the world changes. You put stickers and stuff and you X out...
Oh,
like
I
the next time you play, you're
that.
Like, well, the Ukraine is no longer there. We're
well,
sorry,
that would be accurate now.
Yeah.
Like,
well,
I think that would
time.
Be.
Right. There's trouble. There's trouble in the Ukraine. I should have mentioned something else.
I just hope Kamchatka isn't next. I mean, if you look at the way geopolitics works, Irkutsk, I'm worried for.
Right. Exactly. But the, but that's interesting. And then the, what about the terrain?
Like, the terrain
you
is
buy
all
the
you
terrain?
Buy. Yeah, you can buy it. They will sell you anything.
Right.
They will sell you extra hats. They will sell whatever you feel you will need.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know,
because if it's just a board, then it's all flat terrain.
And it's not all flat terrain. Well, I mean, yeah, you could do it a couple different ways. You could just have different elevation markers or whatever.
Okay.
But usually it's somebody bought a hill. Somebody bought a thing, and then of course at the battle bunker down in Westminster, they've got the whole nine yards. There's castles, there's fortresses.
Right, it's like a train dork who's got tiny
no, that element is in there too. I mean, yeah. It's like an omni hobby that's just swallowed up other nerderies into its maw, and it will satisfy any urge you have to be someone in the basement. You know what I mean? Like whatever you feel you need to do while you play Peter Gabriel Genesis, they will have they have that for you.
That is available.
Yeah.
Now, okay, so we're at I wanted to, because I never played this, which is the Star Wars Old Republic
Online. I played
it
last night.
So, oh, fair enough. Now is it like Warcraft where it's a monthly?
Yes. Oh, well, no, you can play it free now. It's free to play. I've been a subscriber since it launched, so I feel the subscriber model's better. $15 a month, you get everything.
Right. Star Wars: The Old Republic Online RPG.
Yes.
And it's for your PC. Or is it, can you play it on the PS3?
No, it's a PC game.
Okay.
It's free to play now. They just released, I'd kind of lost interest in, they added a new, the basic core of the game is a Star Wars version of World of Warcraft kind of game where but it's fully voiced and it's fully cinematic. So they did voiceover and each class has its own story. So there's four classes on the Empire, four classes on the Republic. It's set thousands and thousands of years in the past where they can do whatever they want with the story.
Awesome. Yeah.
But they've used the art direction so it all looks like Star Wars. So you still get to play Star Wars. Mm-hmm. You know, even though, yes, technically it's thousands of years ago, but your TIE fighter basically looks like a TIE fighter.
Right, right.
You know what I mean? Like, it's slightly different. The
so
wings
is it
are curved.
Space battles or
yes,
is it planet
there's
battles?
Both.
Okay.
There's, and they just added a thing this year that has renewed me and a lot of people's interest in the game.
Yeah.
Which is called an expansion called Galactic Starfighter. So that now, in addition to your regular RPG walking around fighting PvP, whatever you want to do, there is a 8-on-8 and 12-on-12 Twitch combat space battles with a starfighter that you get to level up, and you could be a bomber or an interceptor and it's really arcade combat where you're flying your thing around shooting the other people. And
are you flying through terrain or
you
flying
fly through space? There's three different there's one scenario where you have to capture these three satellites and hold them for longer than the other team. And then defense turrets appear around the satellites. And they have 12 ships and you have 12 ships and you're talking to each other and fighting. It's pretty great.
And so are you on headphones?
If you want. You know, you don't have to do the headphone thing, but it's there if you want it.
Right, right. If you know somebody or you want to meet people or whatever.
Yeah.
And so you're part of a...
You can be in a guild or if you. I'm not. I've never had enough time to devote to the game to have a guild because I don't bring the computer on the road with me.
Right.
So if my guild mates were like, "Why aren't you in the raid?" I'm like, "Cause I'm at the funny bone."
Right. You know, because the desktop works better than a laptop anyway, right?
Yeah. I play on a laptop though, but I'm not going to bring that massive laptop when I have an iPad. I don't want to fly with it.
Yeah, yeah.
So when I get home, my Star Wars is waiting for me.
Right. And is it key command?
Key command with a mouse.
Okay.
And my guys, I have a Jedi Guardian is my main dude. He's like and it's funny that it's all voiceover. So your guy talk or your woman, you can have either. Sure. They all talk the same. So when you're in a group conversation, since the same voice actor plays the Jedi, there's like four people that look differently. If you've all picked the same character class, they all talk the same.
They all
so that's
talk
weird.
The same. That is weird.
But on the Republic side, you can be a trooper, which is basically the clone trooper guy.
Okay.
He's not a clone, but he has the white armor. And then there's a smuggler, which is your basic Han Solo kind of archetype.
Mm-hmm.
Then you've got two kinds of Jedi. There's the Sage, who's more Force powers, more Yoda-ish, and the Guardian, which is more fight with the sword-ish.
Right, right.
On the Empire side,
you pick Guardian.
I pick Guardian.
Yep,
same bashy boy guy that I've always been in every game. My friend James makes fun of me. Like, have you made your fist fighter yet, John? You done that? Your lawful good fist fighter? Making all those light side choices, are you, John?
Andy insists that his buddy Phil only plays ninjas in every game. He's like, I don't care if we're in space. I don't care if we're in the past. Your character is a ninja.
And my friend James will always play snipers. He's
snipers?
All points in sniping, whatever the fuck it is. He likes to hide in bushes and shoot people. And I know somebody who's always stealth.
That's hilarious.
But so on the Empire side, you can be bounty hunter.
Okay.
Bubba Fett. Yeah. Sith warriors, basically Darth Vader. Sith Marauder is – or Sith
– Darth Maul.
Yeah, Darth Maul, or you can be the Emperor. See, each class splits into two later on, so you can specialize a little more. Your Han Solo guy can either be stealth or he can be gunslinger.
Okay.
Your Sith guy can either be the Emperor with a bunch of lightning or Darth Maul with a double blader.
Right.
So – and then there's Imperial Agent, which who's like basically their version of the smugglers, Imperial agent with a sniper rifle, mm-hmm. who also can stealth. The stories are pretty cool. Every scene is fully voiced. So like when you get into like when a typical MMO, when you would click on a quest thing,
yeah.
and there's a question mark, and then you read your thing that you don't even care about, and you yeah. just skip because fuck it, what do I click on?
Right.
Star Wars tries to make that one step more interesting by putting an actual scene with actors walking around and talking.
Okay.
And it works for the most part. Like, once I've gone through the quest once, I don't need to see the scene again. But I watch all the cutscenes.
But how many people are playing? Like,
on any given server on the Republic fleet, which is usually where you're standing around if you're Republic, it's about 163 people, and then the starter worlds will have like 80 or 90 on them at any given time. And okay. the starfighter battles pop every couple minutes. Like if you're queued for a starfighter battle, it comes up. Like they launched a little ambitious and they thought it was going to be a bigger hit than it was, but they figured out the right server size now. They got a stable population and it's yeah. growing again. Okay. So,
Who makes it?
BioWare and Electronic Arts.
Okay.
So it's basically a sequel to Knights of the Old Republic, which was an RPG for the console.
Yeah.
So it's set like 100 years afterwards, but it has some of the same characters. But that's my when I was a kid, I'd played Star Wars action figures. Like that's yeah. what I like to do. So now at 40, I play virtual Star Wars action figures. But it's the same
Why
thing,
not?
You know. Look
yeah.
what I got, a new armor for my Sith Lord.
And then you just go for it. That's, yeah. it's so great. Okay. Yeah, so I just wanted to know about, because that business model is so crazy to me, because Warcraft was like $9.95 a month, but a million people were playing a month
yeah.
or something insane, right?
Well, a lot of that was Asian people that play in internet cafes, though. There's another business model over there. So when they would say like 7 million subscribers, 5 million of those were in Singapore in an internet cafe. And
right,
it was a
but
little
were
murky.
They all given 10 bucks a month?
Or the cafe was? Or
okay.
I don't know. Like
okay.
I don't know exactly how that
oh,
worked.
Oh, right, right. So if the cafe is a member, you don't have to.
Yeah, I think it. I don't know. I don't. I've never been to Singapore with the express purpose of playing video games. So
have you been to Singapore?
Never been anywhere.
Okay.
I know there's a lot of Far East stand up tours that are popping up.
I'm
now,
going
though.
To.
Are
Hong
you doing
Kong.
It? You're doing a Hong Kong?
Yeah,
is that
yeah.
the one at Domian?
Tom Rhodes just did it.
Okay.
And
it may be the same run.
Ryan Stout. I don't know. There's
okay.
different. There's different runs, and then there's going to be some comedy festival, I guess, in September in.
Okay.
In Hong Kong. Hey, Hong Kong listeners, go find Chad Daniels in September doing stand-up comedy.
You should see Chad Daniels, though, if you're in Hong Kong.
Everywhere you go. Yeah. Whenever Chad yeah. Daniels is talking out of his joke hole, go look at that. Because that's good times. And then, so, let's talk about comic books, because
yes.
that's the basic. I mean,
that's what started it all. I was 3 years old. I mean, I was a Doctor Who fan from, like, 11,
mm-hmm.
but I was a comic book fan from, I saw my first comic book on the newsstand under the Loyola L stop in 1979.
Right.
I was 5 years old and it looked like Green Arrow was going to kill Batman on the cover and I needed to know
if it
whether
was gonna
that
happen.
Happened or not.
Yeah.
So I got my dad to buy it for me. I had to pick one. Mm-hmm. My dad would only buy one. So I would have to sit there and fucking in an excruciating, what had to be very annoying for my father.
Right.
He's going to teach me fiscal responsibility, but the cost is his patience.
Right.
So
and time.
Now you get to stand mm-hmm. there while I go, this one or this one or
this
one
or
this
one.
So he did instill in me that. Because to this day, I don't buy a whole lot of them every month.
Right.
And my friends are like, I got to drop off, you know, I got to stop buying so many. I'm like, well, why don't you just buy the ones you like? Didn't your father make you stand in a train station?
Yeah.
But anyway, like,
what if I like all of them,
yeah,
John?
That's
Ryan.
Not an option. And,
turns out it is an option. And you just
yeah, it's called
out,
work at a comic book store.
Right. It's called,
that's the option.
It's
I work at Meltdown.
Figure out how
now.
To make another $150 a month so that I can buy all the comic books I want. That's what my dad used to be. He was like, well, I got to go find $100. By the way, you only ask once where someone finds $100 and then you go, good luck, and then you never. And then you just accept that there's going to be
doing,
lunch.
They're not money caves.
They're not money caves.
Because D&D is based on the idea that there are money caves, and if
right.
you need another 100 gold,
there's
you go
a secret
kill a guy.
Cave full of dragon shards. If anybody needs to go into Drome, okay, go.
So what? Yeah, I bought that comic book and then I never stopped. I did stop. I didn't buy really comics much in high school.
Yeah,
and I didn't buy them. And then at the middle of college, I got back into them, and then dropped it again. And so I've been in and out, but I've been pretty steady for the last 6 or 7 years.
Well, and the good thing about comic books now is that you can sort of keep up with the story, even if you because you. I
There's
mean,
trades.
I'm sure you want to see the art, right?
Yeah. I mean, but I like the story too. I probably go more for writers. Like, I mean,
well, do you think that, because I heard that this is, somebody was saying this, Lee, I don't know who the hell it was, but was saying that it used to be all about the artist back in the 60s and 70s. And now it seems to be that
I think it's
the
always
writers.
Been half and half. Because if you think about, well, in terms of the appeal of the characters, I mean,
like fame wise, like did people know who the writers were? Did people know who
Stan
the artists
Lee,
were?
I see. This is what I don't really get about that. You can say that all you want, but Stan Lee was absolutely more famous than Jack Kirby or Steve Ditko. He right. talked to you on the cartoon.
Which
he
one?
He said Excelsior to you. He talked to you like he was your buddy.
And
like,
is Stan Lee the writer or is
he the
artist?
Writer.
Okay. And like, Jack Kirby's the artist.
Yeah. And Jack Kirby made them look all the way they do.
Right.
The Fantastic Four are memorable because of their blue suits, not because of whatever fucking words Lee put in their mouth.
Right.
But I don't know if that's necessarily true because Stan Lee was far and away the most famous figure in comic books. There's just it's just no disputing it.
Yeah.
He makes cameos in the movies.
Well, now for
right.
sure. But
I'm saying that, I mean, I remember he was on Spider-Man and his amazing friends in the morning. Stan Lee, True Believers, Face Front, you know, Excelsior. Like,
okay.
The worst Stan Lee impression ever done.
again, another
squeaky
safe
voice.
Space. Doesn't have to be accurate.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know. I mean, I feel like the artist.
Do you like the art better than the writing? Do you
it
like
doesn't,
them? It's,
they're
it's,
all the same. I like the story being told. And
yeah.
if one of the leaks weak, if one of the links is weak enough, it diminishes the enjoyment value. Like, okay, I love the graphic novel or whatever it is, the trade Supreme by Alan Moore.
Okay.
But the art is, and I'm sorry, whoever did the art, it's horrendous. Until
okay.
Chris Sprouse gets on towards the later issues. It makes it, it's still a great story, but it makes it hard to read because I'm like, look
yeah.
at his fucking thighs. Why are they drawn that way?
Right.
That being said, there could be some amazing art, like, you know, Tony Harris or P. Craig Russell or whatever. If the story isn't good, I just can't get through
yeah,
another
yeah.
page.
Some things
like,
are really gorgeous.
It's real
synergy.
It has to be, they both have to be helping.
It does. And what one of my favorite things about comic books is how different the art is from story to story. And even from the same story if they switch artists, but the way the characters look. And I was like, when like they changed I think it was Batwoman or and I was like, that's not what she looks like. But then, like, by the second issue, I was like, no, that's what she looks like.
Sure. It's kind of funny because,
like four panels.
What people look like, you would think that would be more standard
yeah.
than it is, that they would have nailed that down.
Right, right.
But, like,
but it's kind of
aside
cool
from
that it
dark
isn't.
Hair, what does Bruce Wayne look like?
Right.
You know
right.
what I mean?
Just
like,
a white
he's
guy
handsome.
With dark hair. Yeah.
But that's all. Like,
and
he could.
It's whatever your version
you
of handsome.
Every Marvel man is a blonde man around 32. Can you honestly tell me why Steve Rogers and Clint Barton look different?
Right.
Or why either of them look different than Henry Pym, or why any of them look different than Warren Worthington.
Right.
They're the same fucking guy. They just have different clothes
is
on.
Is Warren Worthington the angel?
He is the angel.
Okay, there you go.
Yeah.
He's not been in enough X-Men books that I've only been reading them for about 10 years.
Okay.
And so.
Well, they've been fucking with Angel pretty big time in the last 10 years. Like, he's Archangel. Now he's the Angel of Death. Now his
right.
brain is wiped.
Right,
now he's a young version of himself.
Exactly. And I think I was in on that brain is wiped business, but
yeah.
there's so many different versions of X-Men that I will only read two of them.
Okay.
I'm like, screw you. And I can't do, like, I love how Bendis writes,
do you?
But I don't love how Bendis can't end anything.
Robert Kirkman introduces me as Bendis. Whenever we're hanging out, if somebody goes to Robert and recognizes him,
oh,
Robert will
hilarious.
Go, this is Brian Michael Bendis. I'm like, fucking stop. I'm not, I'm way younger. I think I'm thinner than Brian Michael Bendis.
I have never met Brian Michael Bendis.
I like Powers.
I love Powers.
I don't like his Marvel writing. I really don't.
No, I can't. I can't do it. Just because and this is, I am sorry, Brian Michael Bendis, if you're listening, seems unlikely.
Yeah.
But here's the thing, is if my theory has always been, if he had written the Avengers movie, the entire movie would have taken place at the shawarma
yeah.
restaurant.
Well, here's the other thing, yeah. too. He's addicted to last page reveals. So Secret Avengers, which, by the way, Secret Invasion, Stan Lee did that story in one issue. I did the whole story
yeah.
in one issue, just
did
so you know.
Did you read The Invincible, The Big War?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it was amazing. It was like,
turns out the war's over.
Yeah.
And it was one whole great episode
yeah.
issue of Invincible.
There's no reason that you have to draw. And like, so like every Secret Invasion was blah,
was,
blah,
was
blah, 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 last page. Now I'm in town. You know, like that
yeah.
was it. I don't know. I didn't like
yeah. it was, well, but it's like. Yeah, it's your Warhammer example.
Yeah, I always felt that like bad superhero comic book writing And there's certain authors in particular, but I'm not going to, again, trash people.
Yeah,
as I just said, I love
doing...
Powers, so I'm not totally trashing Bendis. I just don't like the Marvel work.
And I love his... nobody writes dialogue like that guy.
True.
It's hilarious
Except
and
the
smart.
David Mamet and Aaron Sorkin that he's emulating, but in the comic book world,
Or
no.
are they emulating him?
I think they got a time machine and they read...
Yeah,
they went back
unlikely.
And wrote Brian Gary Glenn Ross. But anyway, my point being, there's a couple other authors that I don't like. They sell a lot of copies, but I don't really like them. Where I feel like – I was talking to Kirkman about this too. Their version of a superhero comic is if you filmed an 8-year-old playing with his toys in a sandbox and then transcribed that. Like,
right.
Here comes Shazam. Oh, no. Is he going to win? Oh, no. Here comes Sinestro. Whoa. And wait. Oh, no. Is that Hal Jordan? Oh, no. And like then someone's like, okay, then what happens? And then he goes back to the computer with his little mini DV footage of the kid in the sandbox and goes – Shazam from stage left, and then Hal Jordan and Sinestro.
I feel like that was every 90s book that everybody keeps wanting me to read.
Fuck
reads
all
like
that shit.
It was hard.
If you want to read something from the 90s, read Planetary. You did it.
Oh, I read.
Like,
I read that. That was great.
Can I plug cool stuff that I'm reading?
Yeah, that's what this is all about now.
Okay, Hawkeye. Is the best thing ever.
Hawkeye?
It's what AHA and Fraction are doing is so far above the rest of the superhero comics that they're doing Nirvana when everyone else is playing hair metal. I mean, it's that.
Mad Fraction. I will read almost
anything.
The visual
storytelling is on a level that has not been done since Dave Gibbons, and you need to read that shit.
What's Dave Gibbons?
Watchmen. He was the artist
right,
for
right.
Watchmen. Daredevil, Mark Waid, and Chris Samney.
Oh, yeah.
Equally good, visually done book.
Yeah.
That's all I'm reading in terms of Marvel superhero comics.
Just Hawkeye and Daredevil?
Yeah, they're the only good ones. I mean, I hate to be that. Like, they're
for
the
you,
only ones that are on
you,
such a great
friend,
level that
that's
I'm like,
fine.
Artistically,
right.
I got to read that.
And I read both of those. Those are
Saga,
amazing.
Get into it.
Yep.
If you're not reading Saga, you're dumb.
You are not dumb if you're not reading Saga. It's excellent, but you're not dumb.
Maybe you're a smart person that hasn't read Saga yet.
You just
but
haven't
when you
read
Saga.
Saga yet. Saga's
you
beautiful.
You realize
it's amazing.
The times that you weren't reading Saga
were wasted times.
Maybe you were being dumb then. that's all I'm trying to say. If you have any interest in really good comic books and you chose not to read Saga, it might have not been the smartest
but
choice.
If you don't read comic books, don't worry about it.
If you don't read it, don't even start at all. Please keep your life.
You're good.
Harder than it is.
Right, because otherwise there's hoarding.
Destroy yourself with these pictures.
Do you read Electric?
No.
Me neither. I don't do it.
I read... digital?
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely I do.
And then my phone
read. I don't read hard copy anymore. I travel everywhere. I can't bring them. I can't own big things. I can't have an apartment full of stuff. I need to do it digitally now. And also, I'm addicted to the panel view, the guided view.
You love
you
it?
Zoom in. Oh my God, I love it.
Okay.
When I first read a comic that had that, I'm like, it's a whole different thing. Ah! Like,
all right.
Yeah, like, I love
cool.
it. Starlight, the new Mark Millar is very good. And also, I like Jupiter's Legacy. And
which one?
It's another Mark Millar, Miller. I don't
What's
know how
it
you
called?
Pronounce it. Jupiter's Legacy.
Jupiter's Legacy.
And
okay.
I don't like, I didn't like Kick Ass. I didn't like Superior. I didn't like Nemesis. I was kind of done with Mark Millar.
I didn't like
Kick Ass. But these next two,
these ones are good.
These ones
Starlight
are good.
And Jupiter's Legacy.
Yeah.
Awesome.
I read Invincible still. I think that's gotten good again. There was a little bit of a lull and now I'm back.
Right.
I like Earth 2.
Right.
Now that Tom Taylor has taken over,
He's
doing some incredible shit. And look, I love Starman. James Robinson was one of my favorite writers.
Okay.
But I really didn't like what he was doing on Earth 2. It was really long-winded and took along a lot of dialogue, took along.
I'm reading Huntress and Power Girl in
the Paul Levitz one?
In DC.
Yeah.
And then I'm reading Animal Man still.
Is that Lemire?
It was, I think so.
Or Lemire.
And it was, I don't know how to pronounce
DC,
it.
DC, I read Astro City. Or that's
Astro
that's Vertigo,
City's amazing.
Right?
Yeah.
That's really good.
I read all Brubaker all the time.
Do you really?
Velvet?
I don't have enough time and money to read everything.
Right.
I love Ed Brubaker. Oh, if people are Brubaker fans, can I plug, Google John Roy Ed Brubaker.
Mm-hmm.
I do 5 minutes of stand up at Meltdown about to bring Ed up and I do a whole routine about the Winter Soldier and the Bucky run. It's a 4-minute stand up bit that is very specific to Ed Brubaker's writing.
Yeah.
And I think if there's fans
out there. Did he get to see it?
Oh yeah, he was there.
Oh good.
Yeah, he saw the whole thing. thing.
Oh, that's right, because you were bringing them up.
Yeah, it's on YouTube. It's John Roy, Ed Brubaker. I think you'll like it.
Right. We didn't even mention, I did your podcast, so you have a great podcast. Why don't you tell the people about your podcast?
My podcast is called Don't Ever Change.
Right.
It's on Feral Audio, or it's just on iTunes, Amazon, whatever.
Right. Don't Ever Change.
You get your podcast called Don't Ever Change. We interview comedians about high school.
Right.
So we've had Jackie on. It's a really good episode. Mm-hmm. We've had a lot of people who I'm sure have been on this podcast.
Sure.
We've
just a lot of crossover
Moshe Katcher
stuff.
And Kyle Kinane and Matt Pronger and Jonah Ray and Matt Myra and Howard Kramer, Brody Stevens.
Any black people? Any women?
Yeah.
And
we've had a lot of women.
Any gays? Anybody without a leg?
Jackie Cation was on.
Cameron Esposito? Do you have anybody?
We're going to, but we got to reschedule it. But we've got Emily Gordon and Aaron McGathy and Sarah Schaefer has been on and Shelby Farrow, Ron Funches.
I'm just
Baron
saying
Vaughn.
There was a list of the bearded youth movement, and I was like, no, I get it.
And, no, I know. So, I have a lot
I'm just
of.
Kidding. I was just
we have a lot of diversity here.
It's all good. So, but it was really fun, and so it's a good pod if you're looking for.
Oh, I want to plug one more dorky thing that I've been involved in. It's called Maron in Space.
Oh my
god! And me and James Adomian took some money that IFC was gracious enough to give
us,
and we filmed a 5-episode Star Trek the Original Series parody with James Adomian playing Mark Maron in the Kirk role, and then Mark Maron himself playing the evil Maron from the evil mirror universe.
Oh my god, it was so good.
Thank you.
But it was so good. And I've tweeted it and posted it. I will put it in the notes. And Maron in Space.
What are the comic books at the top of your pull list that every week you go, I'm reading those first, I don't care? And also, do you do that, or do you save the filet mignon and eat the appetizers, or do you go ahead and eat the steak and later on? Do you really? I'm always the other way around. Like I try to do that and be that guy who's gonna keep something to the side and wait. But for the most part, I just devour the cupcake and then I eat the crackers later. I just can't I can't do it. I don't have that kind of. I would just like to point out to your listeners that Jackie just pulled out a prodigious stack.
I know it. Well, this is okay. So, like, I haven't read this Dead Boy Detective thing is pretty fun from Vertigo, and it's just some British youth that have clearly been they were killed at their school and now they solve crimes there.
Okay,
I'm giving it a shot. This
well,
is
you
only
know, stick around the old school, help out a bit, even
exactly.
if it killed you. Yeah,
I'm reading Posehn's Deadpool, which has gotten so good.
How funny
so
is
good.
It?
It's you know what. It was too funny, the first 6 episode arc.
Too funny?
Yeah, it was too...
What do you mean too funny?
Too punchy. Too punchy with no story. Not a story,
it was
right?
more just gag, gag, gag.
Yeah, it was too gaggy.
What Demadius Giff- Oh, there it is. Oh, man. What a great comic.
Yeah,
I cannot shut up.
What the hell is this? Is this Winter Soldier? Oh, this is Winter Soldier.
That's Winter Soldier. Oh, that's the
Superior Spider-Man.
I don't care.
Awesome.
I don't want any Doc Ock and
or
whatever.
You
like it?
Oh, they nailed it.
Did you like Doc Ock to begin with?
Nope.
Then
I haven't read Spider-Man since I was 14.
Huh.
So.
But the idea of
Guardians of the Galaxy, the movie. Did you see the trailer?
I don't know.
And you probably never knew anything about Guardians of the Galaxy. We've been reading it for about 4 years. And, and it is very funny.
Is it going to be a good movie?
I think it is.
Maybe?
I think.
I guess we don't know until
we see it. It doesn't look like it's,
Chew, I like. I'm way back on trades, but I think that was, that's really
Chew is amazing. Rat Queens. Rat Queens is funny. Just kick ass. It's very D&D. It's four ladies, with swords. Beating the shit out of everything.
Okay. Like
always
Powerpuff
good.
Girls with gore.
A little bit. All a little bit. Legendary. Haven't gotten into it yet. Animal Man.
I like Green Arrow that Lemire does.
Oh, you know
with
what?
With Sarantino on art, it's really good.
Yeah, I haven't.
It's weird that the two superhero comics I read regularly are both Archer titles.
Right. I don't. Right. Hawkeye and then that. This is one of the X-Men. This is the Lady
That's
X-Men.
That's the All-Lady one?
The All-Lady one, I read that one.
Claremont always wanted to do, but was thwarted.
Uh-huh. Unwritten?
Unwritten, I have read. That's really good.
That's great. X-Factor used to be amazing, and I'm giving it a chance because it's Peter David, and I love Peter David.
You like Peter David?
I do. I do indeed. Oh, this thing. Fucking Rachel Rising, Terry Moore. It is so dark.
Oh, really?
And so funny and so horrible. Not before bed, people.
Okay.
It's about...
there's some 90s for you. New Warriors.
Oh, yeah. New Warriors.
That's about as 90s as it gets.
Right. See, Andy loves a teen superhero group.
I look at New Warriors and immediately L7 and Green Day are playing in my head. That's how 90s that is
See,
to me.
I always read Iron Man first ever since the damn first movie came out.
Really?
I never read it before.
You go Tony first, huh?
I never thought I
it's
would.
It's a cool new suit of armor. What's it all, black and yellow or something?
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's Bumblebee. He's also a Transformer. He
yeah,
turns
you're right.
into a
he is
into
Bumblebee.
A,
I never really thought about that.
It's not okay.
Now
this
just
thing
ruined
is amazing.
It for me. You ruined this, the new Iron Man
I'm so
for me.
Sorry. Have you read this?
No. Nope.
This is the Luna Brothers. Remember
okay.
those guys?
Yeah, I know them.
Okay, so they wrote Girls, and they wrote Sword, and they wrote what was the one before that? Ultra?
Yes.
And Girls was amazing. The Sword was awesome. And this he wrote with Sarah Vaughan.
Okay.
It's called Alex and Ada. And it is a futuristic androidy sentient robot thing.
Okay.
So.
Oh.
Yeah.
Rosal, Jeff Smith, R-A-S-L.
Oh my God. That was so weird and awesome.
I love parallel universes. So if you've got parallel universes, I'm in. I'm a massive Fringe
Jeff
fan.
Jeff Smith, Rosal.
And Rosal, if you haven't, you want to read a cool, it's not that long. It's like 20 issues. You can get the trades. You did it. You read it. The story's there. You
done and done.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, that's,
and then I always recommend Incognito by Brubaker.
Oh, it's so good.
As an intro
he
to Brubaker.
He gets mad when I'm like, write more. And he's like, read Fatale. I'm like, write more. Read Fatale. Write more.
Or, yeah, like, or read Velvet.
Okay.
Because Velvet's amazing. Velvet is.
And it's not Cthulhu-y.
No, it's so
when
great.
I read something and find halfway through that I'm reading something Cthulhu-y, I run out of the room. Like, I'm like, oh, he got me. He made me read some of it. Get it out of here.
All right. John Roy, where are you going to be in March? What's going to happen?
I'm
going to
be
April?
In Los Angeles in March.
How about
I'm not
April?
Going anywhere. I'm going to be
you.
Right here in LA. Where a thing that I wrote with Adomian is going to be filmed. Watch for a new web series. Well, it was just a web video of Jesse Ventura running for president.
Excellent.
And then if you want to see me do stand up, I'm at the Meltdown the 26th of March. That's in a comic book store, so you might enjoy that. I'm doing. The Sleepaway Camp show at the Downtown Independent.
Okay.
And I'm doing the Super Serious show at the Virgil. Just look at my Twitter, and all those dates are on there at John Roy Comic.
Thank you so much for being
You're
on
welcome.
The show. Thanks a lot, Rangers. Take care out there. Bye. All right. That was great. Thanks so much for listening to the show, you guys. The bonus content, which is Andy and I discussing the show, is available on the apps, the Libsyn-sold apps. For some reason, Libsyn is also just posting it for free, so you don't have to buy the app. You can just go to tdf.libsyn.com if you're just downloading it to your iTunes and putting it on some other app to listen to all the different podcasts that you listen to. So if you want to listen to the bonus content, just go to tdf.libsyn.com, or you can buy the app if you want. And you can also just go to iTunes, by the way, and review the show. iTunes supposedly cares about that, so if you're enjoying the show, and I read them. And that's great. And if you ever want to email me, jackie@jackiecation.com. The credits, of course. Patrick Brady's going to fix this audio. Thank you, Patrick. Mike Rickberg composed and sang the intro song. He's going to sing the Mexican hat dance right here in a moment. And Vilmos fixes the website, jackiecation.com, where, by the way, there is a donation button, jackiecation.com and dorkforest.com. Feel free to donate. I'd love everyone to give me $100 a year. That is $8.33 a month. I have not figured out a way to make that easy for you. You would have to remember that, or you can just throw me some money. If you don't have any money, that's fine as well. But feel free to talk up the show. And if you would like merch, if you'd like a Dork Forest t-shirt or a CD of my stand-up comedy, or would like to know where I'm doing stand-up, go to jackiecation.com and hook yourself up. There's also an Amazon banner. If you want to, or if you ever order from Amazon, and we all do, go through jackiecation.com and the Amazon banner. Thanks a lot for listening, everybody. See you next week.
My hat, my hat, my hat. They're dancing around my hat. My hat, my hat, my hat. Well, what do you think of that? If it looks like a Mexican hat dance and it sounds like a Mexican hat dance, it's most likely a Mexican hat dance. So take off your hat and let's dance.
Yay! Oh, my God. Why don't we just call that as the end of the show?